apply if I for I die if I finish and if sometime I if I keep go back to the
不坐在上面，但是这两位三不一拜的修行人呢，是我的徒弟。我要不坐在上边呢，他们也不敢坐在上面。所以呀，我这不得已呀，我先坐在上面。那么坐在上边呢？ 一边留一个空位，给他们两位坐。本来摆这个台的人呢，我不知道为什么摆了四个座位在上面。另外一个人我不知道我是算的哪一个，但是我想一想，叫谁上来好呢？叫国瞻上来。 国航回来就不喝醋，叫国义上来回来国修也喝醋，说这个做师傅的完全不公平。那么虽然这是坐在上面和下面没有什么分别，但是这个人呢就是这么奇怪，你有一个境界来了，你做的不太。 公平啊，他就要啊，找麻烦了。所以呀、啊，那么我叫国威把这个凳子拿下去一个，你们谁也不要争，啊，谁也不要喝醋，啊，谁也不要妒忌，谁也不要仗。我跟你们讲话，你站住点。
Originally, I wanted to sit down. I did not want to sit on the platform today. But these two cultivators who bowed are my disciples, so. I really couldn't avoid sitting up here on the platform. And there were two places up here for them to sit. Now the people who set up the platform, I don't know why, but someone put up four chairs. And I don't know who the fourth person was that they had in mind. And I thought it over about what I was going to do, because if I had Guojun take that seat, then maybe Guohan would have gotten jealous. And if Guoyi got up there, then maybe Guoxiu would have been drinking vinegar. And saying that their teacher was really unfair. Now, although we know that whether you're sitting on the platform or you're not, it really doesn't make any difference. But people can be really strange. Gathering and people get seated in the wrong places, some people are going to start grumbling. So I told Guo Guo to take that extra chair away, and that way have to be jealous. Or upset. So as long as I was up here, sitting up here, I thought I might as well say a few words. Now I thought I'd go ahead and say a few things, and I'm not a very good speaker, but that doesn't matter. If you're just good listeners, that's what counts. Now, maybe the two cultivators might not want to speak. So I thought I'd first sort of pave the way, sweep the road. And then once that was done, they wouldn't be afraid. Now, although I didn't go out and bow once every three steps, I think that it's possible that back at the temple where I was working harder they were. I was enduring even more suffering. Why do I say this? It's because every day I was very busy helping prevent them from having any big problems. That was what I was hoping to do. I'm not saying that I could do it actually, but I was wishing for this. See, you have to note, I said I was hoping they would have no trouble. I wasn't saying I was keeping them from having trouble, so you should know how carefully this is phrased. And this was so that, well, let's say there was some problem, then people would have gone around saying, oh, that Dharma master, he says he has spiritual penetration, but then why did his disciples get in trouble in their bowing? Now, it's not that I really care, but about my reputation. In this way, but I still wanted to prevent them from, say, getting run over, or in some other kind of an accident, maybe blown away by the wind or drowned. So that would have been a problem. So that's why I say I may have been working even harder than they were. So they were out on the road all this time, and they weren't afraid of the wind or the rain or the sun, the heat of the sun. And so nobody here today is allowed to wear a hat. If anybody has got their hat on, being disrespectful of the cultivator. So somebody tried to give me an umbrella. How could I possibly go for something like this? I mean, what would it look like? Nobody else has an umbrella, and I'm a big sissy up here with an umbrella. So I'm trying to act like the emperor. So so I want to be just like all of you. And if the sun is really getting to you, then go ahead and put your hats back on. Because I've got some hair up here. It doesn't matter. But those of you who have just shaved your heads, the sun might blister your head off. So you shouldn't do what I tell you to do. Because everything I say is half true and half false. It's not entirely true. And it's not entirely false. If the false part makes sense to you, then believe in that. And if you think the true part makes sense, then believe in that. It's up to you. You pick whatever you want. I can't speak this too clearly. Because if I told you the whole thing, then you wouldn't be using your own judgment, your own Dharma selecting eye. And if you insist on me telling you absolutely everything, that's not really right. So I'm just going to tell you that it's half true and half false. Do you understand now? If you pick the false part to believe in, then you'll get cheated by me. But if you pick the part that's true, then you cultivate according to the Dharma, and you'll gain benefit.
Now
probably what happened were the Bali monks listened to this half and half teaching of mine, and they managed to pick out the true half, cultivate according to that. And they just let the false part be. That's all. That's all there was to it. Okay?
Just asked me while we were bowing up if I had died yet, and I should explain this so nobody would get the wrong impression that the master was maybe wishing bad luck on myself. The dying that the master was talking about was the dying of the self, the dying of desire, and not the dying of the person, not the design of the cultivator. I should be really careful because everything speaks the Dharma. The wind speaks the Dharma. When I open my mouth and don't speak really truly, then retribution comes. And it's right here that disasters begin. So maybe this vase is speaking the Dharma and saying, Kung Chao, this is a warning. Everything you say should be really true and right on the mark, and not the least bit arrogant or false, because if it's that way, then for sure something bad is going to happen. Not just for you, but for all living beings, because you're a left home person. And because you're a left home person, and everything you do is for everybody, not just for yourself. So the wind was giving me a warning to be really careful. So I should listen. And that's really what I want to talk about. That's an example of the Dharma that we've learned from 2.5 years of bowing. Is to be really true and really honest and really straightforward in everything we do. A newsman came up and asked, "Why are you bowing?" And I said, "We are bowing to try to get rid of disasters and calamities and suffering in the world." And he said, "Well, what do you mean? Do you mean man-made disasters like broken homes and unfilial children and car accidents? Or do you mean natural disasters like earthquakes and tornadoes and floods and famine?" And I said, "We mean both, because both are the same. Both come from the same source." And he said, "I don't understand." And when Hung Shu and I started this pilgrimage, we didn't understand either. We were brought up in a Western society, educated according to the best scientific tradition, so quite naturally, we didn't believe in anything but our egos and ourselves. We didn't believe that, as it says in the Avatamsaka Sutra, all karma is born of, all retribution is born of karma. That is, everything that happens to you comes from what you do. So we decided that it was a matter of life and death to us to be really careful of what we were doing on Sanbui Bai and to run a little scientific experiment so that we would have something to share with people who didn't believe this. Because if you don't believe this, then there's no way to end suffering. No one saves you but yourself. No one can and no one may. You yourself must walk the path. Buddhas only show the way. So the master says he speaks half true and half false. If you don't know which one to follow, then you can be in really, really bad straits. If you know which one to follow, then every day is happy, everywhere is peaceful. So I wanted to share just a little bit today of some of the experiments we ran on Sanbui Bai and what we learned from them. And I really seek the compassion of the Avatamsaka Assembly of Buddhas and Bodhisattvas to help me make sure that my words are true and not arrogant or false for the sake of all beings. The two outstanding lessons of this whole pilgrimage are both within the Flower Adornment Sutra. One is that everything is made from the mind alone. And the second is that everything that happens to you comes from what you do. First day we started out in Los Angeles, we found this to be the case. Right away we met all manner of strange people and beings who came to test our vows. They came to test Hung Shu's silence vows and trying to see if they could get him to talk. They tested our vows not to get angry by really pushing us up against the wall with testing situations. And in all of this, we were instructed right from the beginning that no matter what happened, we couldn't fight and we couldn't get angry. And that all we could use was kindness, compassion, joy and giving to deal with all situations. This was really hard for me because I'm used to fighting. Not so much with fists, but with words and with thoughts. And using to push my weight around. And this is just another kind of fighting that doesn't work. We found that when we held our precepts, this is really important, the five precepts are the basis of everything. If you can hold the five precepts, not only are you assured of never being born in the lower regions as a hell, a hungry ghost, or an animal, you're always assured of being born at least as a human being. This is really important. And if you keep your vows, if you make vows and keep your vows, then wherever you go, you'll be okay. Now, we found this to be the case when we started bowing and got up to Vandenberg Air Force Base. At this time, incredible storms came up. I guess you'd call them typhoons. There were winds up to an exceeding 100 miles an hour all throughout the area, and heavy flooding. Trailer trucks and semis were blown off the road, and whole little towns were completely leveled by these winds. At this time, we hadn't really done anything too bad. So we had kept our precepts pretty much, and we were holding tight to our vows, and for some reason we came through okay. We never got touched by the winds, and we never really got touched by the rain. Wherever we went, who was ever looking after us and taking care of us was really compassionate. And we came out okay. In fact, days went by when it was pouring rain, and it never rained on us. And as soon as we started false thinking about, gee, it's not raining on us, we got drenched. There have been times when we could actually feel the presence of, I don't know what to say, protecting spirits, not only of our teacher, but of spiritual beings around us, protecting us. This happened at the beginning in Los Angeles. I'm sure at one time had a vision of going to Bodhisattva just before an accident took place. And there was no accident as a result. His young daughter was running off with men. She was only 15 years old at the time. He was really worried. He was really mistreating his young child physically and emotionally. And he and his wife were contemplating getting a separation. After reading the Vinaya, he put it to practice, and about 7 or 8 months later, they stopped on their way to a vacation. And they all looked really good. They were all together, happy. The younger daughter, older daughter had come back home and was living with them again. And the kids were really bright-eyed and happy. And he attributed to that book, the reading of Vinaya, following the rules. And he said, you know, it may seem really old-fashioned, but it's made a big difference in my life. So we really found that all our problems come from selfishness, and all disasters come from greed, anger, and stupidity. We've seen this in bigger ways too, and I want to talk about these because they don't often get talked about. Hung Shur and I have been really skeptical about these things, but now I've come to really believe them. For example, it's a fact that there haven't been earthquakes in San Francisco. Now, why is this the case? And San Francisco is right on the San Andreas Fault Zone, and it should have earthquakes. It should have gone under into the ocean a long time ago. And it's clearly because of the vow power and the precept way virtue of our teacher. I don't say this to give anybody a high hat, because we've been told not to give high hats. So I'm giving a high hat to the power of the Dharma and to the power of pure precepts, that the way and the response intertwine and are hard to conceive of. That if you're really pure, then magic things happen to you. And the city of San Francisco hasn't had any earthquakes, nor has Hong Kong, when we were there, had any typhoons when the master was there, because of the same thing, because of cultivation, because of the power of pure precepts. When we were in L.A., we rode down to L.A., and we barely made it to L.A. The storms were so bad, the roads were flooded out, and we were in the blue VW bus at the time. We floated through a couple of puddles on the highway. The tires weren't even touching the ground, it was so heavy. We got to L.A. and there was a medicine master reception ceremony going on. And all the people in the L.A. area had come to Goldwheel Temple and were holding a medicine master repentance to eradicate the causes and conditions of disasters and illness and suffering and calamities. And at this time it was really strange because the mayor of Los Angeles had declared a state of emergency. In fact, many homes had been wiped out and things were bad and there was more storms coming in. And yet, the Goldwheel Temple and the surrounding area, nothing happened. And many of the disciples came back and reported at that time that in their neighborhood, huge trees had gone down and ruined homes right next door to them, but in their own homes, nothing had happened either. And at this time, I remember it being said that this was attributed to the sincerity of the people participating in that weekend medicine mastery encampment. We witnessed it ourselves. It was really hard to believe. Not only that, but during the repentance, a huge tidal wave was coming in off the ocean, and somewhat short of the city of Los Angeles, suddenly dissipated and was gone. With every thought, with every act, and with every word that Hung Shrew and I have ever said or done or thought of, that has been marked with greed for food, for fame, for wealth, for sex, or for sleep, has brought us trouble, has brought us disasters. Every time we kept the five precepts of not killing, not stealing, no sexual misconduct, no false speech, no drugs or intoxicants, not even thoughts of those, we've always been okay. And there's been really magical responses around us. So the heart of this whole pilgrimage is that we've learned a whole lot. And of all the looks like bitterness and suffering and cultivation, there's none that isn't happiness. It says, the hells, the hungry ghost, and the animals, King Yama's realm, all animosity, hatred, conflict, slander, and insult, all these evils are caused by greed and attachment to the five desires. So this is what the master was saying when he said, have you died yet? Because if I was embarrassed to go back and bow again in front of the assembly and come up here again, if I had that much of a blush in my face, then the emperor hasn't died yet. Then desire hasn't died yet. And because desire hasn't died yet, then disasters go on. So Hung Shrew and I really feel that if we can get rid of our own desire by a little bit, then the whole world's better by a little bit. And that if we hold on to our little desire and think, well, it's just a little desire and it's mine, then the whole world is polluted by that much little desire. And so it says the Bodhisattva, who looks at all of this and figures out, gee, you know, we're all connected. No man is an island. Everything we do touches each other. He looks at this and realizes this, and he reduces his greed for the flavor of the five desires. So as a result, we were really trying to get rid of our greed for food. We eat a lot of differently now than we did when we started. We eat a lot of sweets and really good food when we started, and found that it brought a lot of trouble. I've really tried to control and reduce my sexual desire, because more than anything, this is the heart of all desires. Because of I greed for others, because I can't see through myself, because I'm confused about myself and confused about others. And because of that, on this trip I almost died because of my sexual desire. In fact, it was in Malacca during the Asian tour that the fruit of my sexual desire came to ripeness, and I almost died. If it weren't for the compassion of the master, I'd be scattered back to the four elements right now, and who knows where my soul might be. For sure in King Yama's region. And so that taught me a lesson, that what's sweet has really bitter fruit, and what looks bitter really brings a sweet heart, a sweet mind. And so it's been a little easier because of that to put down my greed for women, and to see it really clearly that it's not women, but it's my own selfishness that I can't turn around. And so it said, once you stop seeking, you can stop worrying. And then you can reach true ultimate happiness. So I wish to say that we've tried our best to die, and we maybe just got a little sick, so we're going to keep on bowing. And I hope that what we've learned is the value used by all that you need. So what we've done has been good. I hope we all die together and get reborn together. I don't know, we haven't read the news, so we don't know these people. Maybe that's not so good. But I hope you die anyhow. I hope we all die together. And I hope we all stay together and meet time and time again to cultivate the way together and to help each other reach the path. We transfer at the end of our day of bowing to the city here and to all living beings to end disasters and calamities. And so that all of us together can accomplish Buddhahood. And I really hope that this may be so. So I've got my hat on today because that's because I shaved my head and I'm a blister. And I should stop. Keeps me away to all.
神经了，所以一讲就讲了100个钟头。
Everybody, in case you don't know it, Dharma Master Hung Cho hasn't talked in a long time. Today he got a chance to talk and he went into a kind of talking insanity and talked for 100 hours.
No enough. Still no enough. He 要不把你们在这晒的怎么样，晒干了，晒死了，他都不管的。我是受不了了，我想要跑也跑不了了，你说怎么办？我不再多讲一句话了，多讲一话一句话他会出汗了。
I'm not going to say another thing if I really have to give
them that filing. Okay. 请你们坐下。请你们坐下啊。就是要请你们坐下。 最要紧是信心，这个信心是不要讲，讲了半天也讲不完，讲了多年也讲不完。这个信心是无尽法藏。那么我自己这次散步以外。可以说有什么就以前没有的，现在有信心。那么信什么？就信佛、信法、信僧。那个《华严经》里边。二回生烧这个金刚不坏这个不坏心这个菩萨，他有十个不坏心是什么？他就信三世一切佛，他也信菩萨，就是连初发心菩萨他也发心，那么。他也信一切佛法，他也信一切，还有不坏心对于所有一切佛教佛的教训。那么他也对所有一切众生也发不坏心，那么不坏信心。他也对于所有一切白经法也发信心。City of 10,000 Buddhas might be quickly and easily accomplished for the sake of all beings in the world. And we really believe, we have indestructible faith, that this is the source of a lot of goodness in the world. And as I bow to everybody in the assembly, and Khwaja Prabhu, the master says, I'm bowing to 10,000 Buddhas. I'm bowing to 10,000 Buddhas in your hearts, and I'm bowing to 10,000 Buddhas in my heart, and I'm bowing to 10,000 Buddhas. Empty space all around. So that's what Sanbui Bai has been to me, and it's been a source of indestructible faith in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, in all pure white dharmas that can be transferred, in Bodhisattva Dharma masters, in the Buddha's teachings, like cause and effect, like giving is a practice of happiness. We've learned that giving is a practice of happiness. And I bow to all the I have indestructible faith in Bodhisattva Dharma masters, indestructible faith in Buddhist spiritual penetrations, indestructible faith in the clever, expedient means of great Bodhisattvas who can take ignorant living beings like this one And no matter how greedy, no matter how hateful, no matter how many false views we have, they can trick us into going towards the good. And that's my indestructible faith.
Dharma Master Hung Chao saying that, or says that he's still an emperor inside. So everybody should take a good look at him and let's figure out, is he an emperor? Does he look like an emperor? Did an emperor's nose or eyes be emperor?
Or does
he have emperor ears?
Is it
an emperor's mouth? Just exactly what is it about him? Why am I bringing this up? Because he's figuring out now that he sat up behind the podium to lecture, and Dharma Master Shur stood down on the ground. So he probably figured this means that the emperor is shown.
I'm at the city of 10,000 Buddhas, and maybe some people are thinking, well, at the very least, maybe they're enlightened now, or they have some kind of spiritual penetration. And all I can say is that I feel really ashamed because I give off this impression, and it's not the case. Every day I false think. Every day I have attachments. Every day I do bad things. Every day I have bad thoughts towards Hung Shur. Every day I feel like the Master's tricked me into cultivating. Every day I false think, well, maybe I could still be a layman and do this.
Yes, yes.
But then I think, no, I can't be a layman and do this because it makes me sick. I can't go back. I get sick going back. All I can do is be a left-hand person. I've been tricked. So I think all these things. So where's the pure and lofty in this? So I feel ashamed. And yet I tell these stories and you don't know that what's really going on. The man who got up and spoke and said, yes, like the sea, very simple on the surface, but underneath very complex.